It is really, truly redesigned from the ground up. And what we've ended up with is almost an intuitive use of a product.
We need to focus on the customer again and then say, okay, what is the right user experience here? What is it actually that we want to bring forward? And that's our focus point in all the things that we work with.
So at that point in time, we changed the development process, and we also changed the way we control our requirements in order to get to a place where we were more in control of what we are going to deliver.
Hi, I'm Joe Campbell, and I'm pleased to welcome you to this edition of the Roundtable series, where we bring a panel of automation experts together to talk about factory automation, manufacturing, and collaborative robot technology. Today's topic, powered by best-in-class engineering. Very much looking forward to the session. Universal has been an innovator throughout the life of the company, but we've just introduced a brand new product, the UR20, that we believe is really revolutionary, and I personally agree with that. I'd like to talk about the early stages of the development, when actually the product was conceived and you started down this path. Could you give us some background and history on that?
Yeah, so I joined UR between the prototype one or mock-up system and the prototype one that was the first moving robots. And at that point in time, we were only scratching the edge of actually having it running. So we had a lot of, problems around how we actually controlled the project and how we were getting into a state where we had a fully functional robot that could lift 20 kilograms. Mm-hmm. So at that point in time, we changed the development process, and we also changed the way we control our requirements in order to get to a place where we were more in control of what we are going to deliver. There is a detail that we actually start out with an 18 kilogram robot that was changed to a 20 kilogram. Mm. And at that point in time, together with the new design, we had to do a kind of lot of weight optimization. So we had to really remove all the weight that we could from the wrist joints in order to lift those 20 kilograms. Yeah. And as part of this, we supported it by computer-aided simulations in order to have the strength and the fatigue supported by simulations in order to ensure that it could actually deliver the performance we needed.
Now, we have a very large installed base, over 50,000 right. cobots at this point. Yeah. Were you able to tap into that installed base for inspiration?
Definitely. One of our headlines in product creation is to continuously improve and find out how we can do things smarter, better, how we can help our customers to solve the problems in a more smart way than what we're doing. So we should look at it in the same spirit as a company being developing from the startup to the more mature company that we have today. And we take in all the learnings we can. It's actually also a way of working in product creation these days, that we take in customers early on our new designs. What you mentioned about the 50 or more than 50,000 cobots on the market is we get a lot of feedback on the market from there.
Yeah, eventually we have actually set up a data analyst team that are collecting data from the market to better get an understanding on how are the robots actually used and where are we having our issues, of course, so that we can improve our products along the way. And that was part of the journey towards creating the foundation for the UR20.
So how did you connect this very elegant design? It's a very attractive product to look at, and everybody notices that right away, but it has to live on the factory floor.
Yes.
So how did you go about wrestling with those issues?
You can say there is a lot of things that has to be thought about when you think about the design. First of all, UR has a history, and we have a brand. So that's super, super important. And that's also the things that we have discussed a lot mm-hmm. about, that the brand is super, super important, and we want to add a lot into that. And then you can say the next thing is that we, of course, has to be modern. We have to follow what is happening. And then, of course, we are based in Denmark. We have to follow the Nordic design tradition. And the Nordic design tradition is really, really approachable. And that's maybe what makes the cobot a success, that it's approachable. Nobody's afraid of the cobot because it actually looks friendly. So that is one of the things in the design as well that we really had to think about, and we have to work a lot with. How can we actually do that? So we did that with the curves and the design and the friendliness and the fabrics in the design, how we actually got that out. That is a lot of thoughts behind that. And then you can say, then of course, what is the environment that the product has to live in? You have to think about that as well, because most production environments are gray. And there are lots of machines, there's lots of oils, there's a lot of different things, but we have to make something where you can see that the cobot is moving. So of course the color is still a very, very important thing for us, because it actually helps people to be aware, oh, there is something moving here and I should be aware of what it is. So just for the eye, that's what the blue color is for. So that's very, very important.
The question we were really working hard to answer in marketing was, well, then why you are? And so much of what they have talked about here, talking about, you know, the design, how form follows function, how everything, like, it is really truly redesigned from the ground up. And what we've ended up with is almost an intuitive use of a product. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, and that goes all the way from the hardware element to the software elements to the experience of Polyscope on the Teach pendant. Yeah. And there's so much more to come with that. And yeah. So it's going to be so exciting to see the things that we bring to market after the UR20.
So how does this become a basis for the next product line? I mean, obviously you're enamored with this design. It's better, it's faster. What comes next? Are we going to evolve the rest of the product line on this direction?
In general, we keep focusing on making a platform and making that accessible for our partners and customers around, so they can continue utilizing the core platform. So the more possibilities we build in, the more innovation we can have from the whole ecosystem and get innovation to happen that way.
Carsten, are you still learning from the UR20?
Oh yeah, we're still learning, and we're still learning a lot. And it will evolve over time so that we will get even a better product out, maybe even a better UR20 one day. So definitely we learn a lot.
You can say that we need to focus on the customer again and then say, okay, what is the right user experience here? What is it actually that we want to bring forward? And that's our focus point in all the things that we work with. So of course we need to focus on that, and that's also the further development. How will the user react to this? And as you say, it has been really, really positive reactions so far. And that's something that we want to follow up and then to see, okay, what small things can we make even better going forward from here? So that's super, super important.
Okay, Lacey, we are starting to get really positive feedback from the market from this announcement, and we've actually shown the UR20 at a couple major trade shows. The next one's coming up very soon in North America. What kind of gaps in the market do you see the product filling?
The gaps that we were looking to fill with this longer reach and higher payload and much more performant robot were mostly in palletizing, machine tending, materials handling, and welding. Mm-hmm. And the response that we're seeing has been great. We have been working with partners on building demos. We have been including them in the beta testing, so making sure that the software, the Polyscope interface that we're using, that we now have on the UR20, is, you know, operating fully, and that the UR caps will work on it. So they're happy, they're thrilled. We have customers, especially in welding and palletizing, our partners there, our UR Plus partners, who are just really looking forward to getting their hands on this and being able to sell it because of what it's going to open up for them in terms of, you know, possibilities to grow their business, which is really, I think, one of the neatest things about getting to bring a new cobot to market, right? We do all this work together as a team, and we release this product we're really proud of. And then on the receiving end of that, we have our ecosystem, and they are equally thrilled because of what that will unlock for them. And getting to be a part of this whole thing has been really fun.
So we've talked a lot about performance, we've talked about payload and reach and speed, but I want to talk about customer service and support and reliability. Mm-hmm. Significant part of the design. Mm-hmm.
We've had the approach of thinking even more about manufacturability, and based on the more than 50,000 cobots we have on the market, we know the weak spots on our current design, even though it has definitely reached a high level of quality. Mm-hmm. But we are trying to remove complexity in assemblies and the way we do it. That helps both on the amount of components mm-hmm. going inside, but also the weight and the whole structure and what can go wrong. So we definitely think we have a very reliable product.
And at the same time, it is also serviceable as any other universal robots cobot. They are really fast to service, as we have this modular design. Mm-hmm. And that will help at the end of the day if we have a breakdown, that you can either change the robot or joint fast, also because they're so light, so we can go in and change a complete robot.
I think we've got a world-class product that's coming out to market, and I'm looking forward to the product extensions, and we're going to have an exciting couple years ahead of us. I want to thank all of you for being here. This was a great session, and I hope we can do it again.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.